We walked in and saw everything covered in debris. This is a computer that blew in from the Trade Center. We didn't own a computer.
For 10 years, there has been a hole in New York City, 16 acres where thousands died, a sacred site sealed off from the world. But now, America is rising.
I'm in awe every day that I come to work to see the miracle that is happening here.
Thousands of workers, one shared goal: to unveil a new World Trade Center on the 10th anniversary of its destruction.
Everything was evacuated. The area was totally devastated.
What happens to a neighborhood when it is utterly destroyed?
My neighbors had airplane parts, body parts, in their apartments.
When every corner has been touched by death.
In the months after September 11th, the natural inclination of residents and businesses was to flee, and they did.
Against all odds, the few survivors who lived and worked near Ground Zero decided not to give up.
We love this neighborhood better than the town that we were born.
They started to rebuild in a way never seen before, with determination, creativity, and passion.
Bigger and better.
There's going to be a moment that we say, let the healing begin.
On the 10th anniversary of 9/11, the whole world will glimpse a new ray of hope.
This tree survived that horrible day.
If that tree that was buried and left for dead can come back, we all can.
I was always inspired by the scale, the size, the importance of these structures. It was not just the landmark for Lower Manhattan, it was a symbol of the city and a symbol of the country.
It had its daring. It had its sort of charisma of being so bold, but it also had its true limitations. I never thought that it really worked on the ground. There was a feeling that you arrived in a no man's land.
The original towers were part of a large urban campus that swallowed up 16 acres, eliminated several streets, and interrupted New York City's famous street grid. The surrounding communities were completely cut off from one another. The new plan would reconnect Greenwich Street and Fulton Street, restoring civic life at street level. Running directly under Greenwich Street, the busy number one subway line cuts straight through the construction at Ground Zero and links Lower Manhattan to the city at large. The challenge is to maintain an active subway line while building the new World Trade Center around it.
Flag it up, baby. Come on, today while we're young.
Today, beneath the train, one crew is building a three-story structure featuring underground retail stores and parking.
I mean, at some point, New Yorkers are going to be walking underneath that box, shopping in a retail location at the Trade Center site.
Most projects are built from the bottom up, but with a train suspended 50 feet above their heads, this crew has to reverse the process and use top-down construction. First, they drive supporting piles into the rock beneath the train line. After hauling out nearly 15 feet of soil, they pour the concrete floor and build more temporary bracing. This process is repeated over and over as construction proceeds 50 feet directly below the subway. In this way, they engineer an entire building under an active train line without ever interrupting service.
I almost guarantee you, riding the one train, I'm sure with their latte and with their iPod and with their book or their Kindle or whatever they're doing, nobody thinks twice about it, not in this town.
If the construction process produces any serious vibrations, they could shake the subway rails and even cause a derailment.
You can't blast. It's almost to the point of shovels. It's like a caveman process. It's insanity.
I don't think I really understood, and I'm not sure I fully grasp it even today, how complex and difficult downtown is.
This is a computer that blew in from the Trade Center. OK? came in the window.
This wasn't a kitchen.
With their home, art studio, and neighborhood in ruins after the 9/11 attack, Pat Moore and Andy Jurinko faced a daunting cleanup.
We found a lot of paperwork from Cantor Fitzgerald, and we found some checks from Windows on the World. When we walked in and saw this, huge amounts of paper and dust that's everywhere.
It's a little bit like looking at your own death, your own mortality.
Nobody knew what to do. Could you vacuum? I mean, people just didn't know what to do.
These are black dishes.
This is new. This is brand new.
It wasn't just the tools of daily life. Much of their work was destroyed, too.
I doubt that there's much I can save in here. I am a knitwear designer. I've thrown away a lot.
And this is a painting that...
Andy managed to salvage some of his paintings.
That's what's left of Jane Mansfield. It really looked a lot better when it wasn't covered with dust and dirt. So it was flat on the ground when I first came into the building. It was covered up with debris, glass, and metal, and dust, 2 feet thick. It has a few severe damage problems. But in a way, it kind of adds to the story of the painting.
Others from the building began to come home.
There are 24 families in the building. And essentially, we have acted as a little village.
They worked together for months cleaning up their building.
I looked around and I decided that if I went into that bathroom and I closed the door, I had a space that I actually could handle, you know, a space that made sense to me. It wasn't so overwhelming. And I actually kind of got to the point where I could see the floor in the bathroom. And I said, all right, I'm going to be OK. I'm going to be able to do this. We shoveled debris out of our home for 9 months. We didn't think about ourselves as survivors, but yeah, I guess we are.